What happened?
Nothing.
She's crafty, she's got a grind. She's crafty, and she's just my type.
She's crafty.
Incredible. That's the only way to describe it.
Loft, CEO of UBS Group Americas, resumes his former role as UBS's Group Chief Risk Officer. Philip J. Lofts was Group CRO between November 2008 and December 2010, becoming CEO of UBS Group Americas in January 2011. He joined UBS in 1984.
He was kind of a shady character.
Caleb, do you know when Jehovah wants us to tell the truth?
Telling the truth is like building a bridge with your friends. If you lie, they can't believe you. And they might not want to be your friend.
And I don't give a damn about my bad reputation.
What's that?
Crafty, sneaky, underhanded, devious.
It seems like the Swiss bank UBS in hot water at the moment.
Yes, and not just in France, also in hot water on the other side of the Atlantic. On Thursday, the US Justice Department filed a lawsuit against UBS, saying that the bank lost billions for investors on residential mortgages. And here in France, public prosecutors have demanded UBS pay a fine of 3.7 billion euros for helping wealthy French people avoid taxes. Selena Sykes takes us through the case.
At least 9.76 billion euros of undeclared wealth, allegedly hidden by Swiss banking giant UBS. Accusations made after whistleblower Bradley Birkenfeld came forward against his former employer.
The problem was with tax evasion and money laundering.
UBS is accused of illegally approaching French clients, including businessmen and sports stars, and convincing them to hide their money in Switzerland. The money laundering and tax evasion trial in Paris is the biggest of its kind, with the French state as the civil plaintiff, asking for 1.6 billion euros in damages. The National Financial Prosecutor's Office is also calling for a record fine of 3.7 billion euros. Six current and former UBS bank managers also on trial could face prison sentences and fines of up to 500,000 euros.
Not such a big lie.
All lies are bad, even little ones. One lie leads to another, and they cause much harm.
And, according to certain records, some of them had got prosperous. Some of them had got wealthy.
The settlement closes the chapter on the last investigation by a Justice Department task force on the role financial firms played in the collapse of the housing market in 2008. The Swiss banking giant UBS agreed on Monday to pay $1.4 billion to settle U.S. claims that it misrepresented bonds backed by mortgages sold in the years leading up to the 2008 financial crisis, a sign that the legacy of the turmoil that engulfed the global financial system continues to haunt Wall Street. The settlement with UBS is the last action brought by a Justice Department task force that was set up in 2012, during the Obama administration. It investigated the role of big banks and other financial firms in selling flawed and predatory mortgage products that contributed to the collapse of the U.S. housing market, federal prosecutors in Brooklyn said in a news release. The substantial civil penalty in this case serves as a warning to other players in the financial markets who seek to unlawfully profit through fraud that we will hold them accountable no matter how long it takes, said Breon Peace, U.S. attorney for the Eastern District of New York. UBS said in a statement on its website that it had reached the settlement with federal prosecutors to resolve a legacy matter, adding that the money had already been accounted for in previous financial statements. In settling with UBS, U.S. prosecutors agreed to dismiss a lawsuit it filed against the bank in 2018. The agreement brings the total fines and penalties collected by the government task force to more than $36 billion. Some of that money has gone to providing mortgage relief to homeowners hurt by the financial crisis. In the crisis, which began to abate in 2012, banks foreclosed on more than 6 million mortgages, and millions of other homeowners saw the value of their homes plummet for years. At its peak, the Justice Department task force had more than 200 lawyers working for it. The group also relied on personnel from a number of federal housing agencies, the Securities and Exchange Commission and the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Regarding UBS, federal prosecutors said the bank defrauded bond investors who had sunk money into 40 so-called residential mortgage-backed securities that UBS had sold in 2006 and 2007. The lawsuit filed by prosecutors claimed UBS knowingly made false and misleading statements to investors about the quality of the mortgages that were packaged into those bonds. The bonds sold by UBS eventually lost most of their value when the housing market crashed and homeowners were not able to keep up with their mortgage payments.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Bradley Birkenfeld. I'm the UBS whistleblower. I exposed the largest and longest running tax scandal in the world at UBS in Switzerland.
Do you remember who told the first lie?
Satan.
Right.
Hey, fellas, have you heard the news? You know what Ali's back in town.
But what about Jesus? Would he ever lie?
The French court has ordered Switzerland's largest bank, UBS, to pay $5 billion in fines for tax fraud. The court in Paris found the bank guilty of helping wealthy French clients stash undeclared funds in Swiss accounts through aggravated money laundering. The penalty is reported to be a record for such a case in France.
The Swiss bank before us deliberately entered the United States, actively sought U.S. clients, and secretly helped those U.S. clients defraud the United States of America. UBS has specifically acknowledged wrongdoing and admitted in court that it, quote, participated in a scheme to defraud the United States and its agency, the IRS.
UBS used a variety of strategies to conceal their cross-border activities. They instructed their bankers who traveled to the United States to falsely represent the customs that they were traveling for pleasure. They also recommended that bankers rotate hotel accommodations in the United States to avoid detection. UBS bankers used counter-surveillance techniques, including encrypted spreadsheets in codes to help prevent the detection of their marketing efforts, as well as the identities and undeclared assets of the U.S. clients.
Even though UBS had...
And at a time when millions of Americans are losing their jobs, their homes, and their health care, it is deeply troubling that thousands of the wealthiest among us have actively sought to evade their civic and legal duty to pay taxes. The Department of Justice is committed to doing all that it can to aid the Internal Revenue Service in locating those who would seek to hide behind secret accounts and to hold them accountable under the federal tax laws.
UBS was fined $780 million. A complaint filed with a court in Florida enabled them to demand that UBS deliver the identities of 52,000 American clients suspected of tax evasion. It was a declaration of war, a matter now for the highest levels of state. Micheline Calmy-Ray, head of the Swiss Diplomatic Corps, met with Secretary of State Hillary Clinton in Washington.
There has been an agreement reached in the litigation that was just reported to the court in Florida that confirms there has been an understanding between the Swiss government and our government over the ongoing litigation concerning UBS. I'm very happy to begin the discussions with her.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
These were difficult negotiations. They went on for months. On August 21st, 2009, the Swiss government announced that it had agreed to provide U.S. authorities with the names of 4,500 clients.
Ladies and gentlemen, in recent months, the federal government has, for the first time, acted on behalf of a company. It has taken extremely high risks to minimize the damage that certain representatives of UBS have inflicted on the reputation of the Swiss financial sector and hence the entire country.
While their conscience is bearing witness with them, and by their own thoughts, they are being accused.
Business is doing really well.
Crafty business practices.
What would you do if you were tempted or pressured to commit some sort of wrongdoing? There are many people in the world who would give in to the temptation or the pressure, especially if they felt that they could benefit in some way, and they thought no one would find out about it.
Riches often serve selfish ends, and they may be gained through crafty or even illegal business practices.
I kept telling myself that it was no big deal.
The chief priest directly challenged Jesus' authority to disrupt their business. How would he respond?
In Luke chapter 12, you'll remember that Jesus taught an illustration regarding a rich man. Do you remember this? Let's open our Bibles and read it together. Luke chapter 12. And verse 16, now just before we read it, you'll remember that the purpose of Jesus giving this illustration was to emphasize the importance of being rich toward God. Now let's read what he says here in verse 16. The land of a rich man produced well. So he began reasoning within himself, what should I do now that I have nowhere to gather my crops? Then he said, I will do this. I will tear down my storehouses and build bigger ones. And there I will gather all my grain and all my goods. And I will say to myself, you have many good things stored up for many years. Take it easy. Eat, drink, enjoy yourself. But God said to him, unreasonable one, this night they are demanding your life from you. Who then is to have the things you stored up? So it goes with a man who stores up treasure for himself, but is not rich toward God. Well, what was the problem with this man? In the 2007 Watchtower, August 1st issue, this illustration was discussed. And the Watchtower said that the rich man's plan provided really only a false sense of security. Practical as it might have seemed to him, it left out one vital element, God's will. The man was only thinking about himself, how he would be able to take his ease and eat, drink, and enjoy himself. He thought that because he had many good things, he would also have many years. Isn't that an interesting point? You see, he thought the abundance of things that he possessed would somehow equate to the length of his life. But the Watchtower went on to say, too bad for him. Things did not work out that way. Just as Jesus said earlier, even when a person has an abundance, life does not result from the things he possesses. Well, that brings us back to James chapter 4. Let's go back there again and look at what verse 15 says. See, after commenting on how a life is just like a mist appearing, then verse 15 says, instead, you should say, if Jehovah wills, we will live and do this or that. You see, the Bible makes it clear we should never ever develop overconfidence. Overconfidence in anything in our position, our knowledge, our wisdom, our wealth, but instead, you see, have complete confidence in Jehovah. But really, our only hope, our only confidence is with Jehovah. Now, this applies not just to our view of life itself, but really also to our view of all of our activities. You see, in that verse in James chapter 4, it says not just about our life, but about whether we will do this or do that. So it really applies to all of the different things that we do every day. Well, now, what do we learn from this? Everything going along very smoothly. 2 days later, the Kingdom Hall was padlocked. All the literature was banned in the country. The bank accounts that belonged to the branch and to the congregation were all seized. Well, suddenly, and very unexpectedly, our work and all of our activities had been banned in that country.
Now, you all know why that was incredible. Only Jehovah could have been responsible for that.
Read this together. James 4, verse 13. Says, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we'll travel to this city and we'll spend a year there and we will do business and make some profit, whereas you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. For you are a mist that appears for a little while and then disappears. Well, that's true. You see, really, no matter what privileges we may enjoy, how skilled a teacher we may be, what knowledge we've accumulated, we're all just like a mist appearing for a while and then disappearing. Well, this is an idea that occurs over and over again in the scriptures, and really with the purpose of encouraging all of us to take a close and sober and serious look at the way that we use our lives, and even more importantly, how we use them to serve Jehovah.
Who do you want to be like?
I want to be like Jesus.
Good, my son.
Jehovah gave us a conscience so that we can evaluate any situation that arises in life, make a right choice, and then judge ourselves afterward on the choice we made. If we allow ourselves to do what we know is wrong, our conscience will surely strike us. Then if we repeatedly ignore our conscience, it will malfunction and become insensitive, and it will not recognize dangers that could damage our relationship with Jehovah. The first time a person does something he knows he should not do, his conscience may prick him and he may feel guilty. But if he does it again and again, his conscience will gradually fail to respond, and he may get involved in even more serious wrongdoing. Seemingly small compromises often lead to larger ones, and larger compromises further distance people from the happy God. And that leads to feelings of worthlessness and heartache. Whereas a clean conscience that results from obeying Jehovah brings us self-respect, personal dignity, and real joy. Now, how can we safeguard our conscience so that it is always clean? By studying Bible principles and meditating on how to apply them, so that when we are faced with important decisions, we will know how to respond in a way that will contribute to our joy. We have to sensitize our conscience by learning and loving Jehovah's view of what is right and what is wrong, and being convinced that living in harmony with His standards is the best way of life. And that is how the psalmist David felt. If you'd like to turn to Psalm 19, verse 8. Psalm 19, 8, he wrote, the orders from Jehovah are righteous, causing the heart to rejoice. The commandment of Jehovah is clean, making the eyes shine. So maintaining a clean conscience in all areas of our daily life will bring us joy in our use of alcohol, in business dealings, with entertainment choices, and in our dealings with the opposite sex. And when we have a clean conscience as Jehovah's people, we are not ashamed to give a witness to others. As the Apostle Paul wrote at 2 Corinthians 1:12, we can boast that our conscience bears witness that we have conducted ourselves in the world with holiness and godly sincerity. At times it takes real courage to be honest and to face whatever consequences may come our way.
So what happened there?
I broke it. It was an accident. I crashed my plane.
I'll talk to Victor.
Don't throw yourself under the bus, man. We'll help you get this cleaned up. No one will have to know.
This is one of the most expensive units in the shop. You take the blame, and you're just making yourself look bad.
No, it's okay. It was a mistake. I'll explain it. We need to get this back online.
In the end, I think Victor actually appreciated my honesty. And he wasn't the only one. Mark had some questions. And we had a great discussion.
This time, instead of his conscience troubling him, Ben had real peace of mind. He also gained the trust and respect of others. How can you have a clean conscience? By being determined, as Hebrews 13:18 says, to conduct yourselves honestly in all things, whether other humans are aware of your good conduct or not. Then you can sleep each night with the satisfaction of knowing Jehovah is pleased with you. As they say, there is no pillow so soft as a clean conscience. It rewards us with peace of mind and joy.
Thank you for telling the truth. Next time something like this happens, what should you do?
I'll tell the truth. And can I tell Mom I'm sorry?
Good idea. Let's go do that right now. And then we'll pick up the broken pieces.
We thank you also for the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society of Pennsylvania. That's the reason why we have been here, for one of the reasons, celebrating the annual meeting. And we appreciate how over 100 years, well over 100 years, this society has been a great support to the governing body in caring for their responsibility.